There we go.
Good morning again.
Good morning again. We're good to go. Thanks. Thanks, Mike. Once again, I'm Glenn Faber with Purdue Pharma.
I'm Dan Aronofsky, also with Purdue Pharma.
Great. And we certainly are glad to have you at our session today. So what Dan and I are going to do, over the last 2 years, we at Purdue have taken two of the ASIS standards, and we've implemented those into our security programs at Purdue. We did the Workplace Violence Intervention Prevention Standard back in 2012, and then we did the PAP standard last year. We've also done presentations on those before, so some of the information, if you've attended our sessions before, will look familiar. However, today what we're going to do is we're going to take you what we felt worked best for us as we took these processes through. We'll hopefully show and create an easier path for you should you guys decide to implement these standards as well.
So our previous presentations in 2012, Glenn and I presented on adopting the ANSI/ASIS Workplace Violence Prevention and Intervention Standard, and in 2013, the Physical Asset Protection Standard. How many folks here are members of ASIS currently? You know, you all are able to download a copy, a free copy of any of the standards, and today, or at any time with your membership. You're also able to purchase them, the hard copies at the store, and then at the Standards and Guidelines booth, which is 4955, they have a CD with all of them on there. With your membership, you can grab it there. So let's take you through the simple process which Glenn and I used to adopt and implement these standards. First, we start with information discussion with some of the key stakeholders at a very high level, figuring out what we wanted to do. Initially, the Workplace Violence Prevention and Intervention Standard. So we have that discussion, we talk to the stakeholders, we identify further stakeholders who want to be on the implementation team. And we'll get into talking about the difference between the implementation and some of the other teams below that. Then we move into best practices, because what we want to identify is, what we don't want to do is recreate work that's been done by some of our colleagues in the field already. So as you most of you know, that the person sitting next to you is a breath of knowledge for many different things, and this is the networking portion of it, and I want to go to my cards and see what I can get and use, you know, we'll call it best practices or stealing. And then we develop our goals and objectives. How are we going to get to the end result here? What are our initial goals? Very simple, high level. You know, how are we going to implement this standard, and at what level do we want to implement it? Just at corporate? Do we want in our corporation or to spread it out to the other organizations? And then a needs assessment. Can't get to where you're going unless you know where you are. So we needed to figure out exactly what we had in place already. And to do that, once you took that initial step, we developed the all-important gap analysis. And we didn't want to spend any major time doing, you know, Six Sigma, you know, hiring green belts or master black belts. This was a simple gap analysis that we put together with an Excel spreadsheet. I'm going to take you through that. It's 19 columns, so if you haven't slept yet, you will. I'll take you through it quickly. The gap analysis is the important tool that everything runs around. So, you know, and you'll be able to download this presentation and get the column headings, and certainly reach out to Glenn and I for more information. And something didn't fit here very well, task assignments. So then we're going to give those stakeholders what they need to take from that gap analysis and the identified gaps. The results of that analysis. Figuring out the gap closure, so how are we attacking those gaps, which stakeholders are being assigned, and grabbing those, and what are their milestones. And then because this becomes a living document, we want to look at these last two boxes, is developing the review intervals. So how often am I going back to this gap analysis and making sure that I've actually closed that gap and it remains closed. And then maintaining that program, I want to make sure that I'm going back to that and making sure that if the standard's here today and we've met the standard, is there room for us to get better? And that's where the kind of this portion is.
Yeah, what we typically do is we'll take, these two boxes and then we'll go right back to the gap analysis and look and see if we have other gaps identified through the year. And then we'll go through this process once again. So this area really is the meat and the potatoes, really, of this process map, if you will. So then we'll talk about critical steps. What do you need as far as critical steps to make these implementations work? Well, certainly you need senior management support and participation. And we'll talk a little bit more about participation. Identifying your stakeholders. As Dan had mentioned in that process map, you got to know who your stakeholders are. These are some of the ones that we chose to use with our implementation. And then finally, at the end, understanding each stakeholder's responsibilities. We need to know what the stakeholder's responsibilities were with HR and vice versa. It was important, and we found out that that worked well to ensure that everyone understood it.
So further critical steps, sharing and understanding the goals and objectives with the team so everyone was on the level plane. Assigning those responsibilities and deliverables, which was key to keeping these meetings moving forward. And we began every single meeting with the prior deliverables, regardless of who was in that meeting. So if you had a senior manager or senior executive in the meeting, then and they had assigned tasks, we were holding them to those tasks. And that provided that execution, or that execution provided the momentum that we needed to be able to get to the next meeting and get this thing done. It's kind of like a psychological game that we're playing. We all go to hundreds of meetings, and we can get easily bogged down by just going to the meeting and not getting back to our desk and getting the work done. Workplace violence and physical asset protections, I mean, these were things that were near and dear to us and our organization, so it was imperative for us, and we put a timeline on ourselves, right. So it was imperative for us to execute and get that done, and we weren't going to let anyone get away with not completing their tasks. Certainly not Mark Gerasi.
All right, so some key takeaways. As I mentioned, obtaining top-level management support and involvement. I think the critical word here is involvement. Just because you have their support really doesn't go a long way. Involvement means having them in the meetings. We had involvement from our CSO and our senior VP of HR. They were there throughout the processes, and they were at each and every meeting. Stakeholders must be familiar with the entire standard. Okay, they can't come to the meetings unprepared. We ensured, and Dan had mentioned, you got to drive it home that they have to understand it. And then developing clearly defined tasks. What was everyone supposed to do? That was part of the priors and at the beginning and end of each meeting.
So holding the stakeholders accountable, this is key for moving forward, accountability.
Excellent. Sorry, Dan.
Yep. Creating that momentum. And finally, the part that I talked about earlier, the managing the size of the threat management team versus the implementation team. There were members of the implementation team on the workplace violence side that thought that they were going to be part of this threat management team, and it just really wasn't necessary. And we'll kind of dive into that just a little bit further in a minute. So a needs assessment. So is there a program or policy in place? Does it meet the minimum of the standard? If it doesn't, that's a gap. And we'll log the gap and we'll show you how to do that. And then how will the adoption of the standard be announced? So once our goal is to get to reach the level of the standard, how do we share that with our colleagues? How do I get my employees to know about this new program or this enhanced program?
So then we go into the all-important developing of that gap analysis. And as we mentioned, it's certainly an essential step for the implementation. Create a simple template. We made it very simple. You'll see it when Dan goes through it. And finally, we loaded it into a SharePoint site. Made it much more easy. Each person could sign out the document, do their tasks, put it back into the SharePoint site. So we kept track of what everyone's doing through that site.
So key takeaways here are evaluating your needs. Don't create tools that overcomplicate your mission. No need to have that Six Sigma when you can just get away with just doing a, director of security doing it.
The simple gap analysis. And finally, the sharing of data, maintaining one clean copy. And that was done through the SharePoint site.
Okay. This is what I like to refer to as nap time. So the gap analysis, let me take you through this a little bit. So you'll be, I don't know if ever we can see those column headings. This is just for your reference when you actually download the presentation. Right. So we'll just move on.
And keep in mind that, while these are the headings that we used and certainly we felt fit our needs, they're certainly not the, not the golden bullet there. You might have other columns or, other ideas.
Well, that didn't fit either. All right, so the first three columns here are line number, section number, and then what we're is the reference right out of the workplace violence standard. So we started with just this column here, and we started realizing that because there were different stakeholders responding to the same sections, that and when we were talking with each other on conference calls, that it was necessary to throw in this other column here, very simple, so we could refer to, we were talking about line 14, 6.2.8D. And then just a cut and paste of the, a little excerpt from the standard, what you're referring to. Then the next two columns, department or business unit completing the form, and the stakeholder. Because in the Workplace Violence Prevention and Intervention Standard, HR may be reading a section, and they may be the person filling this part of the gap analysis out, but the stakeholder's corporate security. And they're just talking about what they perceive our process to be, and they think that there's a gap. So it was helpful this way to be able to separate the columns, CHS or HR or law filling it out, and it's security's responsibility.
You also notice that we have different colors here within the gap analysis. And what we did there was we identified a business unit a certain color. So if we ever wanted to go back and sort on what tasks or what areas were, and I think corporate security was the blue. So we could just go back into the Excel spreadsheet, do a sort, and know exactly what fell under each business unit.
You think it was blue? As many times we went over there,
you blue.
Think it was blue?
And also, while you can't see it here, these were all drop-down boxes. So, someone filling it out would just go in there, hit the box, and populate it.
Next couple of columns, is there a procedure currently in place? What is the ANSI current process practice? I'll get into that. And then is there an SBP or an SOP? So this first column, is there a procedure currently in place? Simple, yes, no, partially. The next part is this particular standard, early on in the standard, had a section that called out, said whether this would be a can, may, should, or shall for the rest of the standard. So in a better definition, if it said shall, then we needed to implement it in order to meet the standard. And this became a great tool. If we could say anything to the Standards and Guidelines Commission, we would love to see this in future standards, because what this allowed us to do is when we started having trouble with law or HR because it was a touchy-feely thing, and they said, well, let's not do it. And we pointed it back to, what was it, page 4?
Page 4 of the standard, yes.
And we started pointing back to that, and law went, well, all right. I mean, we've already made the, our objective is to get to this, so all right. So the can, may, should, shall. So that's helped us move along. So if we were filling that out and it referred to as, shall, then it was something that we knew we were getting done.
Yeah, some very, very good language. Definitely helped us out.
Back up one. I didn't get that last column. It's self-explanatory. But it's standard business practice or SOP, whether we had a standard business practice, something that corporate security and the pharma world uses, rather than SOP for everything, because SOP takes usually an act of God for us to get changed. Two more. Let's see. Is there a gap? So did we identify a gap specifically? Yes, no, or partially? And the explanation of that gap. what needs to be accomplished in order to meet the standard. So this is our narrative of what we wanted to meet specifically for this that particular section, which was about conflict resolution for the officers, for the guard force. And then whether it is that status of that need, is it in process, started, not started, or completed? And moving along, will there be a training requirement? Yes or no? What would be the procedure to conduct that training? You know, in our case, the contract guard force would be trained within 6 months of being assigned to the sites. And then who should be trained? So there, again, more drop-down menus, whether it be corporate security, the guard force, whether we wanted HR or HR generalist trained in this as well. And then the last couple of columns, last four columns here, notes and comments. It says discussion here, but that's because of our law department. They did not want their discussion shared with the rest of you. So what this was our back and forth, because we were using a SharePoint site. We were all signing out the document and working on it around the same time, feeding it back up and working with one clean document. That discussion was going back and forth, and we were able to execute and get things done where we didn't even have to meet, because the discussions were there, we were able to get it done and see what was going on. We added the target date of when we wanted to accomplish these tasks. What was our goal? July 30th, 2012, to meet that one particular gap. And then, because this is a living document, when was it last reviewed? When was the last time we were going to go through it? Trust me, it's been updated since 2012. And then the last column became very important for us for more momentum. This was more of that psychology, easy, moderate, or difficult, or low, medium, high, hanging fruit. So what this was when I wanted to get something accomplished with the team, I'd go to Glenn, I'd say, well, you know, this week I'm going to pick three mediums and two lows, and we've got to knock these out. And we're going to push the different members of the different stakeholders to get this accomplished. And when we were able to get that done and then roll that up in the meeting, show them what we'd already accomplished. It wasn't just corporate security. It was, you know, HR, law, EHS. When they had tasks, we were able to roll this up and show that there were accomplishments here. They had that momentum. They were like, all right, we're moving. We're almost done. And this document ended up being, what, nine pages. Small font?
Yeah. And actually, you know, this column was really an afterthought. You know, we had gone through the process for, I don't know, maybe a month or two. And Dan had, like you said, he came to me and said, you know what, we're getting bogged down here again. Let's look at adding another column with these areas here of the low, medium, and high. And certainly it really pushed the process along. It was definitely needed. So you put all that work into your gap analysis. We'll take you through some of the results of both of the standards. We'll start with the workplace violence standard. So what we found was policies or programs may not meet the standard. While we certainly had a program in place at Purdue, by going through the gap analysis and the process, we realized that, you know, some of the information we had did not meet the standard. We added different language to our policy. One of them was we inserted threats made by any individual are unacceptable. Our previous policy just stated employees. So you got to think, you know, it's more just employees. You have visitors at your facility, you have vendors, contractors. So we added that language. We also included any work-related activities. You know, do you have a breast cancer walk-a-thon? Do you have company picnics or whatever? We incorporated that language into our program as well.
Additionally, we looked at reporting behaviors that generate a concern. It wasn't in our current policy. It was a very, you know, kind of one-paragraph policy. So we wanted to get drilled down a little bit further, look at the behaviors that generate a concern or changes in behavior, That also identified that we needed more training with the HR generalists and some of the people that are reporting up and supervisors to be able to understand what is a change in behavior that's a reportable concern. We wanted to look at prohibited conduct, but it wasn't limited to the intent to cause physical harm or stalking and harassing. And then we included in the policy the confidentiality and must be maintained through the investigative process, through until a point where it did need to be shared with certain folks. And then that there was a retaliation, no retaliation clause in there.
I was looking at some results from the fiscal asset protection standard. Dan had mentioned that we use, within corporate security, we use standard business practices. A lot of those business practices, included information about our programs. However, we realized that we were missing an overarching PAP management policy. We realized that we had a misaligned convergence. I think we all talk about the IT and the security convergence. When I first started at Purdue, it's been 17 years now, corporate security was over on this side and IT was over here. You know, we never wanted to approach them to put anything on their network. They never wanted our stuff on their network. Well, over the years, with a lot of heartache and a lot of trial and tribulation, we are starting to use the network, and we've made some progress along the way with that.
We identified that our security survey intervals were not clearly defined. So while Glenn was working with his direct reports at the different sites and saying that we needed to conduct our security surveys, we didn't have a clearly defined policy that said when we were going to do them, how frequently we were going to do them, and more importantly, who was going to conduct them. Having me conduct the survey at the same site 3 years in a row is probably not the best security practice. And then ensure tenant compliance with the PAP procedures. And this also rolled into the workplace violence side. We wanted to focus on, I'm in a multi-tenant high-rise facility, and we wanted to make sure that my tenants understood where we were. And I wanted to do everything I could to help them meet the standard as well and give them every tool that I could to make them meet these procedures, because if they're not meeting it, then, it's all for naught.
Yeah, if you're a security landlord, definitely, you need to know what your tenants have. Dan does a good job of working with the tenants, making sure that, if they have a bad termination that they're going to have, that Dan is aware of it, that our security staff is aware of it. So that's an important key takeaway.
More gap analysis results from the workplace violence prevention and intervention standard. A lack of awareness training, we talked about this. The IDing behavioral changes. The missing conflict resolution training for the security officers and HR generalists. And that behavioral profiler access. Our story here is that we all knew, and being with corporate security with Purdue for several years, we all knew that we had access or on retainer a behavioral profiler. What we didn't realize was no one knew how to get in touch with them. That was kept at the CSO level. Right. And so the gap analysis identified that it was only the CSO that actually had the current information, updated information, and that was born to... or showed us that we needed to share that with the right individuals.
Right. Now our whole threat management team is familiar with this group and can reach out to them should the need arise. Liaisoning with the fire department and PD, I encourage all my direct reports to work with their emergency management services. You just never know when you're going to need them. The facility that Dan's responsible for has 7 or 9 entrances somewhere in that neighborhood. Certainly you want to make sure.
You need to confirm or deny that.
Make sure you know they need to know where they're going to go if there's a situation at your site. And then finally, developing that threat management team. Dan had mentioned that we narrowed it down from the stakeholders down to the threat management team, and this is what we're currently using at Purdue. It's Corporate Security, General Counsel, and Human Resource.
So post-gap milestones for the workplace violence standard. We disseminated the updated workplace violence policy through online training modules. So we identify, let's use that convergence. Let's talk with our IT. Let's figure out a way to do send this out like we do our sexual harassment and some other HR and compliance initiatives. And it was at that point we were able to identify what we already had on retainer was an online training module that included workplace violence. We were able to adopt that and make it our own and ship that out to all the new hires, and then every 2 years, I believe?
2 years, yes.
Two years. And that also included added training for more employee awareness training. And that was the Run, Hide, Fight video. How many people here are familiar with the Run, Hide, Fight video? Anyone not? That would be easier for me. Anyone not familiar with it?
Yes.
So it's a great tool, but there's some stories behind that, Glenn.
Yeah, we definitely went through a lot of processes, trying to get pretty much our legal and HR individuals to allow us to put it on our corporate webpage. And, Dan had approached myself and my manager probably three different occasions, and we sort of said, nah, I don't know, we didn't want to go down that road. Finally, after the Newtown shooting, Dan approached us again. We said, you know what, we probably should take a look at this and see if we can get it done. So, we brought it to the group at one of our meetings, and they said, no, we can't do this. It's too graphic, et cetera, et cetera. So after going back and forth and really being persistent with it, that we felt it was the right thing to do, it was the right tool. They allowed us to do it. We put it as a, there was a little disclaimer at the beginning. And the one thing we didn't do, we did not make it mandatory. It was strictly volunteer. If you wanted to go and look at it, you could do it. So we did it, and what I had our IT group do was I asked them if they could put a counter to see how many employees actually went to the video. Well, after a week, I think we had about 90% of the employees went to that video and viewed it and made a lot of comments about, this is great.
Yeah. Glenn received an awful lot of emails right after that. And, with all the doubt that we had, whether this was, I don't think there was a whole lot of doubt in security, but
right.
With the other teams on the implementation, by the time all those emails were flooding in from our employees from around the country saying, it's about time, thank you for doing this. We're so happy that corporate security and our leaders are actually paying attention to this stuff. And, it was on everyone's mind because it was, within, months after, probably a month after Newtown.
So certainly, key takeaway, just be persistent. If you think it's the right thing to do, be persistent with it. Then we took the programs. We developed all the programs first at our corporate location. Then we took them and we rolled them out to our satellite locations. And along with that, we created the satellite threat management team. Certainly, the individuals at those satellite locations, they know the people more than we know them in corporate. So we went down and developed those teams.
We redeveloped relationships with our law enforcement. Specifically, I invited my local police department, City of Stamford, Connecticut, in to do several different types of training. We created some really unique programs where we identified for them we knew that if we were evacuating the facility for, say, an active shooter, and they had snipers covering their people, their force protection coming in, that my officers, who are plain clothes, would be facing the crowd rather than going with the crowd, so they would stand out. So we created flip charts with photographs and names of the security officers that could go with the sniper teams. And, little things that we were constantly thinking of that could help law enforcement in coming into the facility, giving them access cards, giving them key cards with that, or actual key locks. So, and training the officers knowing that if they go to swipe at a door, that our doors make a sound. So you would be announcing that you were about to come through that door. Using the key would be a little more quiet. So working that with the police departments, letting them come in and use the facility for, training and active training, just highly recommended. So post-gap milestones. We got to develop that overarching PAP policy, that physical asset protection policy. So while Glenn has all the directives that talk about, what our lighting standards are going to be, what our cameras are going to be, what our record times and frames per second. All that, what we didn't have was an overarching policy giving leading us into that directive. And the physical asset protection standard does ask for that. Then we developed our standard intervals for the security surveys and identified how the rotation was going to go for being able to conduct those surveys at the different manufacturing facilities, R&D facility, and corporate facilities.
And just as with the workplace violence gap analysis, we took this gap analysis and handed it off to the satellite locations. So now we look at maintaining that program. Obviously, you put a lot of time and effort into all this implementation of these processes. You know, more often than not, people take these programs, they just put the books on the shelf to collect dust. You know, certainly we like to look at and keep these programs going, maintaining those, and how are you going to do that? Well, we're doing yearly reviews of that gap analysis. You saw that in our process map. So that is part of the process. Testing and exercise, you know, tabletop exercises, penetration audits on the PAP side. You know, what else can you do? Working with the fire department and the police department, testing such as that. Threat management team meetings, you really should have these. We have them 2 times a year. You need to know what's going on. We just went through a lot of restructuring with our company. We need to know is the severance packages, are they still, you know, are they still applicable? You know, is what happened to Johnny? Does anyone know if he got a job yet? Those are important things you want to discuss in those threat management team meetings. And then finally, the annual training of the appropriate colleagues. Dan had mentioned we use the online training program. That is part of our annual process.
So you're going to hear this a lot this week, the Plan, Do, Check, Act, continuous review of your policies and procedures. Identify new gaps. Take your time to revisit that program. I think Glenn and I were both a little bit shocked to find when we did do the gap analysis again in 2013 that there were additional gaps that we hadn't originally identified or that were born. And so take your time to review your gap analysis, dig right back into it. And that's part of the assess and audit as well. And then developing a life cycle or return on investment database. What I have to do is, you know, and you'll learn this in other classes maybe this week if you don't already know, you know, I got to sit there and figure out what is the life cycle of my equipment, what is the life cycle of these policies and procedures, understanding that these need to be updated. So, lessons learned. What worked well for us? Senior management support. Got to have that buy-in. I want that executive VP in my meeting if I'm going to implement a standard as important as the workplace violence prevention and intervention or the physical asset protections. I want him or her in that meeting and have ownership.
Right. However, you need to be prepared to reschedule those meetings when the senior executives are not available. They got busy schedules. We have busy schedules. You know, as Dan mentioned, that support is key. So if you have to reschedule a meeting or if they're not going to be there, you got to make sure that you reschedule the meeting because that participation was key.
Identifying the key stakeholders. Remember, separating the implementation team from any of the other, like threat management team or lower teams.
Right. And you got to be prepared that, you know, some of the folks that you have as part of your implementation team, you know, they might get a little offended. Well, why am I not on the threat management team? Well, you got to do what's right, and you got to make what's, you know, going to work well for your organization.
What worked well for us was the introduction of the standards and making sure that all the participants, all the stakeholders, understood and read the standard cover to cover. It was important enough for them to be able to come into a meeting and understand what HR's role was, what law's role was, what corporate security's role was. So when we started our discussions, we weren't wasting any time by trying to rehash or go, well, clearly you didn't read this. And that's
yeah, but be prepared. Definitely that, you know, you're going to have individuals that are going to come to the meeting and they're not going to have read what they needed to read. I mean, it was our first meeting with the workplace violence standards. You know, we asked, has everyone read the standard? And what did we hear? Crickets. No one said a word, you know. So obviously, they didn't read the standard. So that's important to make sure.
Took a little effort, but they got it.
Yeah.
They got it quickly.
Collaboration. This was huge. You know, certainly there was a lot of, there's a lot of butt-heading at times with legal and HR. You know, we went through a lot of different scenarios, a lot of different processes, but it was really a collaborative effort on all parts to get these processes and these standards implemented.
Assigning responsibilities and deliverables. It's a key aspect of this. To be able to accomplish anything, you've got to hold them accountable. Right. And then creating a simple gap analysis. So keep your work simple. Don't dig into the weeds too much. You certainly can take what we provided on this presentation and be able to drill down even further or take some things out.
Right. And you need a champion. You got to have a champion who's going to drive this. And I will say that Dan was the champion to keep this process going. He did a tremendous amount of work organizing the meetings, making sure the SharePoint site was up to date. So you really need to have someone who's going to take it and run with it, because if you don't, you're going to lose that momentum. And there's one other thing that I didn't put up there, but I will say that worked well for me, was implementation of both these standards were part of my goals and objectives, and they were also my direct report's goals and objectives. So that worked very well for not only my supervisor but me. So there was a lot of incentive to get these processes implemented, and obviously, you know, review time comes, and you know, it goes a long way that we did a good job with them.
He held us to it, that's for sure. So keys to security success here is raise the bar with the implementation of the ASIS standards. We found this so valuable to our organization to be able to say that we are all at this level now, and now it's time to even build further on that. So if I had to recommend anything, I would say take a hard look at the standard. If everyone in this room, if all our colleagues were meeting this standard, can you imagine where we would be in this country right now, being able to secure our facilities and be able to talk amongst each other back and forth? We'd all be speaking the same language. So,
and I think, you know, the workplace violence standard, you know, that came out, you know, I think it was 2012 or 11, right around that time. I mean, that was a very, very hot topic, and it still is. I mean, there's no doubt about it. It's still a hot topic, but you know, that standard was done very well, and you know, it really fit in nice to our program. And then finally, that continuous improvement. We talked about that a lot. You know, you got to continuously look for improvements. Don't think that, you know, you have solid programs. While you have solid programs in place, you can always look for areas of improvement. You know, especially, you know, physical assets, you know, your card reader systems, your camera systems, you know, are you vulnerable? You got to continuously look at those programs to make sure. It's important.
All right, so if there are any questions, for Glenn?
trying to implement the standards over a region or a multi-site application, well, there's two parts to this question. One is, who paid for it? And two, what kind of blowback or resistance did you get when the plant manager has a covered net who puts in burglar alarm? He can put that back.
Yeah. Well, I would say, first of all, with the workplace violence standard, you know, I think it goes, you know, we mentioned you got to get the top level support. You know, we for implementing that program, we had it from the our CEO all the way down. So, you know, that one was very easy. Even the alternate sites, you know, we have vice presidents that run those alternate sites. They were on board with it. I will say that one. You know, the physical asset protection one. You know,
no, that's the bidding process.
Yeah.
You know, that's where your procurement teams come in, and you know, and I'm making an assumption you have procurement, but you know, if you've got Billy Bob and he's what he, you know, he's it's the plant manager says it's his. I'm sorry.
Well, no, it's all done at the site level. Yeah, our budgets run at the site level, so it all comes out of those budgets.
Yes, sir.
In terms of your local teams versus the more corporate team, how do you structure communication? What expectations do you have if they're going to have a situation, their communication back to the corporate team, or is it?
Absolutely, yes. The corporate threat management team is really the final deciding factor. So if there was a situation or incident at one of the satellite locations, they would make notification right away to corporate that we got this going on. Obviously, they get their team together during that process and start working it through it at that level. And we have, yeah, definitely communication going on.
Satellite management team discovers the behavioral change. Works with their HR at the local site, reports it right up to corporate, when we all start working together.
Right.
Hey, yes, sir.
We were probably with both of them, I would say, 6 to 7, 8 months in that time frame.
Yeah. We were pretty aggressive on the workplace violence.
Yeah.
That has a lot more momentum. The physical asset protection one, there's a lot less players involved, so it did not take as long as we thought it would, because it was mostly just corporate security involved.
Yeah, and IT. Yeah, the other one had more, you know, a lot more weight to it with the other players involved. And I think as we went through the process, I think the groups of HR and legal, they really started to realize that, hey, you know what, we do have some gaps. You know, we really need to look at this and make it better. So.
Anything else?
Glenn and Dan, let me just add in answer to that. Our budgets are set up differently in the company that I work for. So our physical security budget is centralized at the corporate security level. So we set the standard for the multiple sites. So it didn't come off of the site budget as we did the physical security standard. We were able to do that, but that's something that we've done for years. We now have the standard to be able to point to when we go in for budget dollars, right? So we've adopted that company-wide. And the workplace violence one, we partnered with the other organizations that they said, and we are doing it mandatory with all employees have to sign off on the training. And that's the phase we're in right now, is developing that training that goes on our learning management system on the computer, and so everybody has to take it. HR and legal wanted that from that end, so it worked out well, but it was just bringing the right stakeholders in to be able to do that, and then we had the budget dollars to be able to do it. So,
yeah.
But again, that's the philosophy of the company, is we didn't let the sites dictate as to what level of physical security and therefore what level of prevention they could have with the workplace violence. We just picked up the tab.
You know, and certainly if, you know, feel free to contact Dan or myself if you have any questions, you know, how to, you know, go through the process. If you get bogged down, you know, certainly reach out to us. We'll share, you know, benchmarking, best practices. That's what it's all about here with, you know, these educational sessions. You know, so feel free once again to reach out to us, definitely.
And if you filled out your forms, great. If you want to do it electronically, I don't know if you've got the app now. The app, you can now review all the sessions, and Glenn's giving out quarters for positive comments. So, anything
okay.
else?
No, I think that's it. Thank everybody for coming, and again, as you said.
Thank you.